¿Qué más? What's up, CD?
Lo que estamos pensando hacer, si usted está de acuerdo, es que yo lo introduzco, doy una pequeña brief de qué se va a dar la plática, lo introduzco, usted pasa aquí, ya está la presentación puesta, está el clicker,
okay.
Y acabando la presentación nos volvemos a sentar y Juan Gabriel hace el Q&A. ¿Te parece?
If you don't mind, I'll run this through the back of your side here. Right. Sorry, I already grabbed before I waited for you.
I'm
there, by the way. Okay.
Should I sit here or there?
If you want, si quiere ahí, y ponemos a Gabriel de este lado.
Ok.
¿Me parece?
Cuando usted necesita cerrar el Q&A, no sé si alguien de su equipo, alguien nos puede hacer una pregunta.
O si usted me dice una hora específica, a esa hora decimos ya con el último.
Ok. Sé que tengo.
Lower if you go on your belt line to the belt back
Mm-hmm. Y le podemos cortar un par de veces a ustedes.
Somos tres, creo.
Tres puestos. Le guardamos tres por allá.
¿Por qué están aún en esta época del año tantos estudiantes?
Porque como es el quarter system, no se acabó todavía.
Ah, ustedes son el quarter system.
Sí, hasta la próxima semana vamos a explicar todo.
Específicamente en muchas de las universidades en el East Coast ya no hay gente.
Aquí todo.
Bueno, ¿le parece? Hi, everyone. Thank you for being here, and welcome to the bicentennial of the U.S.-Colombia relationship, continued opportunities for partnership and growth. This event is hosted by the Harris School of Public Policy, Latin American Matters, and Colombians at UChicago. Colombia and the United States established diplomatic relations on June 19, 1822. To commemorate the bicentennial of diplomatic relations between these two countries, Ambassador Juan Carlos Pinzon will speak about the history of the countries' binational relationship, their partnership, and the political challenges that both countries are facing today in terms of democracy, migration, and climate change. These remarks will be followed by a Q&A session moderated by Gabriel Angarita, who is co-president of the Association of Colombians at University of Chicago and a first-year student in the Master of Public Policy program here at Harris. The Q&A will be led at the beginning with some questions on the boundless opportunities Colombia might offer in terms of security, economic recovery, supply chain, migration, and climate change, to be followed by open questions from the public. To introduce our speaker, Juan Carlos Pinzon. On July 26, 2021, Juan Carlos Pinzon was appointed Ambassador of Colombia to the United States for a second term. Since then, the Colombia-U.S. relationship has been taken to a historical peak. President Biden designated Colombia as a major non-NATO ally. The U.S. Congress approved the highest budget for Colombia in a decade. And the bicentennial partnership was launched by President Biden and President Duque as part of the celebration of 200 years of diplomatic relations. Between 2018 and 2021, Pinzon was president of the Foundation for the Progress of the Capital Region, Pro Bogotá, a private nonprofit for the promotion of policy and long-term strategy projects for the capital region of Colombia. He was a presidential and vice presidential candidate in 2017 and 2018, and he served as ambassador to the U.S. for the first time from 2015 to 2017. Some of his other positions include Minister of Defense, Chief of Staff to the President, Vice President of the Colombian Banking Association, and economics professor at Javeriana and Andes Universities. He has been a member of several corporate advisory boards and NGOs. Pinzon received an honorable mention for outstanding academic performance in his Bachelor of Science in Economics from the Pontifica Universidad Javeriana in Bogotá, and he also holds three master's degrees. Master's of Science in Economics from the Pontifica Universidad Javeriana, Master's in Public Policy from Princeton University, and Master's of Defense and National Security from Colombia's National War College. Join me in welcoming Ambassador Pinzon.
Gracias mucho. Gracias. Y este es con el play, ¿ya? Ok, gracias. Bueno, muy buenas tardes a todos. Un gusto saludarlos. ¿Quiénes hablan español aquí? ¿Poquito? Ok. ¿Hablan español? No. ¿Cuántos son latinoamericanos? Wow. ¿Cuántos son colombianos? Ah, bueno, pues somos casi todos, mire. Muy bien. Y yo también soy de los Cowboys. In a great team. Bueno, I think I will switch to English, you know. I just wanted to say hello first to all our Latino community, of course, and of course my fellow Colombians. Great to see you all. So happy to see so many students thinking, processing, getting knowledge, because we need you back there, you know. I hope you don't stay here. I hope you think to come back. Your country needs you. Being Colombia in our case, or any other of yours, we need you there. You know, there's a lot of things to do. Poverty is an issue. Inequality is an issue. the need for development is an issue. The fact of creating economic growth and prosperity is an issue, and bringing security and spreading democracy is a challenge. So yes, we need students like you to go and perform in the years to come. It's a great honor to be here at the University of Chicago. I've been traveling this year to all the major cities of the United States, and I'm very grateful to have been visiting most of the greatest campus of U.S. schools. This is the 17th university I visit, and I've been able to speak, and really it's an honor to be here at the University of Chicago. The prestige of this school, you know, is well preceded worldwide. For all of us who at some point in our life study economics, you can imagine how important it was to read and study the textbooks that were produced in this place. So frankly speaking, you know, I'm personally touched to be here at the University of Chicago, and especially with this kind of attendance in the room. This year has been important because we have been precisely traveling to explain why it's so important to us to be celebrating 200 years of relationship between Colombia and the United States. Colombia became the first country in Latin America to send a diplomat to the United States. It was finally accredited in June 19, 1822. And the United States sent its first diplomat to Latin America, to Colombia, in the month of January 1823. The founding fathers of the United States did care for five principles that are not perfect even today, but that I still believe all of us are thriving for it. Of course, freedom, democracy, rule of law, the respect and protection of human rights, and free markets. Those five principles were the ones that our founding fathers as well looked from the United States as an example. And somehow, you know, we became a country that was always hoping for the same. So the relationship is not just another diplomatic relationship. It is based first on very long-term historic roots, but second is about values. And when I said values, the ones that I described, I'm not saying we have it, nor even the US that is well advanced as compared to us has it already. But what I said is that we still are pushing forward to get those to be real. You know, and probably we'll keep forever trying. And I think that's important. I have a presentation, but I was told, and I fully agree, that the most important time you have it in a school with a course, students and professors, is a conversation, are the questions, are the Q&A. You're right now full of ideas and probably full of clear points of view. And certainly I'm here to discuss that. There's only one good news I have for me, not for you. I am not allowed to speak about politics, all right? And you see what it means? You know, I'm not allowed, you know, legally speaking in Colombia, those who are in public service, is absurd, I know, but I follow the rules. We are not allowed to speak about politics, but you're allowed to ask, and I'll see how I'll figure out how to respond without falling in a misbehavior. Now, I like to start my presentation with this slide, because when I arrived for a second time at the embassy in Washington 10 months ago, we did a strategic planning exercise. We were in the middle of a tense situation at that moment. Things were not going so good for us, neither in the country. We're in the middle of the riots, the consequences of the COVID crisis, and you know, frankly speaking, our social tissue was really harmed. You know, it was a difficult time. But on the other side, internationally, our image was harmed, and in Washington, we were having some trouble. So we were figuring out, all right, how do we move forward, and how we recover our stamina, move forward, and strengthen this relationship as we should. And on the other side was, what do we say? What do we think? And I really believe all my life, all my career in young people. I do care for that. I always believe in the mix. I like to speak about with the elders because they are full of wisdom, savvy people, not always because what they study, but because what they saw already or because the crisis they already handled. But young people has continued to have this idea of change, innovation. Yes, you can. Yes, let's move forward and, you know, bring the spark of ideas. So I went to my core of interns and I told them, I give you a challenge. Make Colombia in one single slide as a whole and try to introduce Colombia in a single slide and tell me who we are. What is the identity of Colombia? And for those who are not aware of Colombia, it's my job as ambassador, my honor, to introduce my country. Probably many of the things I'm going to say here are the same values, same ideas that will work for any of our countries in Latin America. But the only one that gives me a check is Colombia. You know, and by the way, I do it with a lot of honor, so I will do it from Colombia for all. So the first one is nature. That's a big identity issue for Colombia. We are a country of nature. We are one of the countries that has the greatest endowment in fresh water in the whole world. In per capita terms, second to in the world after Canada. We are a country that has very immense areas with no infrastructure and frankly speaking with very limited presence of humans. Out of our country, 49% of the territory holds 95% of the population, and 51% of the country, only 5% of the population. So it's very unique, you know, in the way the country is divided. That's very much about nature. And I have to tell you, I am very fortunate person because I've been knowing my country to places that most of Colombians even have never been. And I'm telling you, we have some of the most beautiful natural parks in the world and are amazing. Second one is we are a multiracial, multicultural, multi-regional country. And that creates a big opportunity. We are, as America is, a melting pot. And with all the challenges that it implies, but all the opportunities and all the benefit for that. And I really believe that's something that we need to be proud to express more and more. Then, geography matters. Colombia is relatively a sizable country. We have the size of Texas, California, and you can add into Colombia a place like Illinois or Virginia. So we are now like the sixth country in Latin America by size. You have Canada, you have the United States, you have Brazil, you have Mexico, you have Peru, then you have Argentina, Colombia, seventh. That's a little bit of the size of the country by territory. But that has blessed and cursed us. Bless us because it creates on every region its own culture, its own cities, its own economic opportunities, and somehow a curse because that has put our country a little bit more divide, but we're a country of cities. We are 51 million people in our country, so we are the second largest Spanish speaking in the world, country in the world after Mexico, and the fourth largest population in the Western Hemisphere, or the 29th country by population in the world. So somehow it's a big market, it's relevant. So we have many cities with more than 500,000 people, so around 15, and definitely one of our cities, our capital city, is one of the mega cities of Latin America, Bogota, which when you see the metropolitan regional area, it accounts around 11 million people. So it's quite sizable, certainly larger than Chicago, only less than New York, LA, definitely Mexico City and Buenos Aires, maybe Sao Paulo, no other than that. The next one, I just put it because I cry every time I see that and I suffer, and you know, it's against my own will. But you know, we have to say, we're not going to a World Cup, you know? And it's one of the saddest events in recent history. But why I go to this? Because as in every other country in the world these days, we democracies are getting into one difficult problem. And when I come to a public policy school, I want to address this. We shouldn't be as divided as we are. We're getting into the point that people cannot talk anymore. But it's absurd. We're more connected than ever. We exchange pictures. We have Instagram. We have Facebook. We have Twitter. We exchange ideas all the time. But we cannot talk anymore. Because the difference are like, everybody lives in its own chamber. And very few things are uniting people, including here in America, sports. Sports and events and things that, somehow represent our flags, that's what is uniting us. Some other things should unite us. But as of now, I think that's important at least to have that to try. Then I love that part, first because it has the natural colors of Colombia, so I love it. But second, because it reminds us that Colombia is the most biodiverse country in the world in per square mile, and second in total. So we have more bird species than any other country in the world, more orchids than any other country in the world, and more frog species than any other country in the world. And we have a lot of reptiles and a lot of very specific species. That used to be just a highlight. In an era of genomics and DNA decoding, who knows what is the wealth of a country like Colombia to the future? But at the same time, it brings a lot of responsibility, because probably that endowment is not ours, it's of humanity, but we have to take care for it, and I think that's important too. And finally, I love the last picture because it represents something that is very important for a country that has suffered as much as Colombia. Let's not forget, Colombia was the most violent country in the world, not in the region, not in the neighborhood, in the whole world by the end of the 20th century. That's not a minor thing. How do we were able to move forward? Well, somehow there's something in Colombians about happiness, music, culture, dancing. We're supposed to be good dancers. I'm not, according to my wife, I'm the worst dancer ever, but I know a lot of people in Colombia that are the greatest dancers ever. Somehow that create this idea of resilience. And even if you go to Colombia in a good day, to any town, you might be lucky of getting that day, the day of, avocado, or the day of panela, or the day of whatever, or you get so lucky and you go to the Barranquilla Carnival, or Negros y Blancos in Pasto. It's all the time. And I think that has been very important to us. Let me just move very fast because, conversation is what matters. So let me talk to you about the 200 years relationship. I think presidents have become very good friends from both our sides. There's only one ambassador of the United States that was president, William Henry Harrison. There are 13 ambassadors of Colombia that have been diplomats or presidents, the presidents of Colombia that have been diplomats in the US. President FDR was the first one who visited us. A lot of missions have come to Colombia. The Kemmerer mission next year, 100 years after, created the central bank and the concept of the concepts related to that are very important to financial system and insurance, and even the fact of having a controller in the nation. Then we have botanists as Schultes that went and found the biodiversity from Harvard. Along our history, we have 200 years of history, 90% of good stories, 10% of bad ones. The 10% is 20 years during the Panama separation. So when the US and Colombia became friends in 1822, Colombia probably was bigger than the US because we were not alone. The Gran Colombia of the time, so the 200 years probably celebrates in other countries, was Venezuela, Ecuador, half of Peru, Bolivia, Panama, Costa Rica, the coast of Nicaragua. So it was a very big country, and the US probably just got to, I don't know if even Illinois was there already by 1822, so we really were a sizable country. But we separated 8 years after, while the US continued to expand to the west, and the last country we kept was Panama. And in 1903, it separated from Colombia. So it was a, an issue because we felt we got some resentment and got the idea that, you know, he was fully promoted by President Teddy Roosevelt. So we didn't like that to happen. But by 1921, we got a compensation, which will never pay the price, but at least was an elegant way of moving forward. Now, on that, we've been very much in the same page, aligned since then. World War II, we were the first country to express in Latin America our grievances about Pearl Harbor. Then by 1843, we declared war to the Axis powers. 1843 also, our Navy fought the Nazi submarines in the Caribbean. There was one combat that did happen. Later on, by multilateralism, Colombia has been with the US siding on the same side. So the UN was created. Colombia was there in San Francisco. Not every country did, only 50 in the world. OAS, the Organization of American States, was created in Bogota, in fact. And Colombia was also part of the charter to create the Bretton Woods institutions, both World Bank and IMF. So I think that was quite substantial and relevant. Not to forget that in 1951, the UN made a call to all the countries in the world to go and defend democracy and freedom in South Korea after the North invasion. From Latin America, the only country that sent troops was Colombia. We sent 5,000 soldiers in total in 5 or 6 rotations and 3 naval vessels that rotated. 800 of ours were wounded, killed, or still missing. And that created the next layer of US-Colombia relationship, military to military and national security. That explains why years later we have had Plan Colombia and we are NATO global partners and all this. It has a long tradition now of, you know, being connected. Every president of the United States have come to Colombia since President Reagan. By the way, before that, President Kennedy went to Colombia. That was a very important one because he launched from Colombia the Alliance for Progress that continues to be regarded as probably the most important US policy for Latin America. Even today we speak about it. And then President Reagan, President Bush, President Clinton, President Bush, President Obama, Ivanka, and President Biden have visited Colombia, all of them. By the way, President Clinton was substantial. We got Plan Colombia. Plan Colombia was a program created at the National Planning Ministry in Colombia, where we thought at that time that we needed to increase our security capabilities, our institutions, both in economic development and in justice, and thirdly, taking rural development to the marginal areas of Colombia. Nothing is perfect, but that program advanced to the point that Colombia was the most violent country in the world, an economy shrinking by the end of the 90s, and really became the best performer for the first 20 years, 19 years, let's say, in Latin America. And I think that's significant on every layer. Then we got a free trade agreement with the US 10 years ago, exactly in the month of May 2012, it started. It has been a win-win. We got investment, we got non-mining exports moving forward. The US got more exports than Colombia, especially on the industrial base. Then we became NATO global partners. We became OECD country. And these past 10 months, few things have happened. The US has been working with Colombia. They donated to Colombia 8 million vaccines out of the 100 million we have doses we have been using. We have been working in a migration program because of the experience Colombia has with the TPS for the 2 million Venezuelans that are living in Colombia. And we have been working on climate change and energy transition. In Glasgow, Colombia became the country that has shown more advance in energy transition in Latin America. By the way, in that regard, There was an area created with Ecuador, Panama, and Costa Rica in the Pacific that is the largest protected area in the Pacific in the world, which I think is also quite substantial. Then, 2 months ago, this very important meeting did happen. President Biden and President Duque met at the Oval Office. Then we, the cabinets, met later. And three things that are important to these days did happen. The first, we strongly aligned together, both the United States and Colombia, with the against the aggression of Putin to Ukraine. And we strongly have taken a stance onto that. By the way, Colombia already participated in the conference of Poland for migrants, using the experience we got with the Venezuelans. We're trying to offer that experience for Ukrainians that are coming to Poland. And second, in the weeks to come, we might make a formal announcement that Colombia will help in Ukraine on two fronts. One on trauma medicine, just because we have so many stories of wounded soldiers, warriors, and policemen in history, that there's an experience there to take care of people with very serious injuries. And second, on the mining. We have been working in the mining in the past 12 years in Colombia, and we have units that have gained some level of specialization that are required, especially in the areas where no more combat is going on, but where munitions and other explosives are around. So I think that's gonna be a good contribution to the world. The second big issue that was presented today was both presidents got to the idea of a bicentennial alliance. And it implies that we are going to include not only the national security issues that we have been including for the past 20 years, but we're going to include also technology, migration, energy transition, and climate change, and a permanent conversation on how to defend democracy, especially in a region that is getting full of autocracy faster than we thought and that we knew. And finally, President Biden announced his desire to designate Colombia as a major non-NATO ally. By the way, 2 days ago, that announcement came formally and is in place. So Colombia became something that to me was obvious, but creates new opportunities to in the years to come, a major non-NATO ally of the United States. And I think that's gonna be important for the purpose of national security and technology sharing, especially in an era in which global power competition is happening. I wish to disregard that, frankly speaking. I wish only that humanity will be sharing technology, knowledge, and everybody can add whatever they had good. It doesn't matter who you are or where you come from, but the world is not like that. And we need to figure out how to move forward in these geopolitical challenges that we are confronting. I will just move to very few data. You agree with him not to work this anymore? Come on. Huh? This is 114 years records of GDP growth. 111 positive GDP growth. Very few countries in the world can show this. Only three dots of recession. The one of the Great Depression, the one of the Argentina and Russia by the end of the 90s, early century default, and then COVID, which happens to be the worst, but by the way, the greatest ever rebound we ever had in 2021. So that's where we are. As you see, when we measure GDP in cumulative growth using a base in 69, it shows clearly that in the 21st century, Colombia overperformed Latin America, and that is very much related to our security efforts that resulted in investment, in consequence in jobs, in consequence in reduction of poverty. So sad we got this 2019 and 2020 better, because it probably created this array. We were reducing even the Gini coefficient. I remember the Gini coefficient being at 0.60 almost by the end of 20th century and moving to 0.47. That was extremely high, but it went back to 0.52. So that's the bad news, you know, inequality and poverty went back. We were able to cut poverty by half, from 54% of total poverty in 2002 to 27% by the year 2019. Where is today? By the end of 2020, it got to 40%. So it went backwards. Today, we're at 35. Still too high. And we haven't been able to recover what was lost out of the pandemic. And of course, when you have poverty and you have a crime and you have terrorism and you have people that have performed that, it's easy to go back to deterioration. So we're in a struggle right now, but I'm sure we're going to surpass that anyway. A good highlight of Colombia is we never had an episode of hyperinflation. And that is so common in the history of Latin America, not in Colombia. So we have other problems, violence, cartels, terrorism. We haven't had hyperinflation, you know, and that's a good one. GDP recovery is clear, and we have higher vaccination rates than even our donors in the United States, which we're very thankful by. The rebound that I explained, every forecast was defeated in 2021, I think is a good news. I like the forecast for the WIO of the IMF, which implies that Colombia, if continues to perform, will be the highest growing economy, about the biggest economies in Latin America, and we'll surpass the region. And if we can keep it up, hopefully we can be a better performer than the region in the years to come. Infrastructure matters has been a very major lagging, we have been lagging in infrastructure for years, as compared to our peers in Mexico, Brazil, Argentina, even Ecuador has better infrastructure than Colombia. 10 years ago, we started a process of infrastructure investment. We're moving forward, and the good news is we just launched a second phase, or the fifth generation of roads, airports, and ports. And I think 10 years from now, Colombia will be a lot more competitive as we advance. Most of this is funded by US major funds. About trade, we have free trade agreement with 17 countries, 1.5 billion access. I like just to remind that 31% of the coffee that is consumed in the United States come from Colombia, that 60% of the roses that you see in this country come from Colombia, and that any tilapia you eat here comes from Colombia. You know, that's a good one. Investment, we have become a very attractive country for foreign direct investment. In 2019, we became the second destination in per GDP terms in the world, which implied that, you know, all major investors were seeking Colombia. Vietnam was really outperforming everybody. But I think it's important to mention. By the way, this year, a month ago, the Global Entrepreneurship Monitor published their indexes. And for the first time in our history, we surpassed Chile and became number one country in the region for, you know, entrepreneurship environment. Let's keep it, because if we can do that, we can keep growing and moving forward. But that's where we are right now. We're a connected country. Almost everybody has 16 million cell phones. Almost everybody's connected to social media. There's almost 70% of internet connections, which is important. And you can reach easily a Colombian in Facebook for the purpose that you want, you know, and easier than any other country in the region. We have a cluster, an ecosystem of digital is happening. We have already two companies describe as unicorns. Is Rappi, and the week before this one, we announced the second one, was announced, Javi, I think is the name. And there are around 100 Colombian companies that already have VC rounds here in the United States, which makes us expect that in the years to come, we're gonna get there. In FinTech is something very special. So we are, by GDP size, probably the 55th economy in the world. By population, we'll be like the 30th, 29th, but in FinTech, we're 14th. So we really, on that, are showing some adaptability and some kind of economic opportunity to what is going on. By the way, the e-trade has grown in like a 34% average per year, and is growing this year. Nature and tourism should be our next real economic industry. COVID, you know, came at the wrong time because the country was starting really to get, you know, we moved from 1 million visitors to 4 million visitors in a period of 2 years. So it was very amazing. Of course, COVID comes down. Still, we get more visitors from the United States than from any other country. This is what I told you already about biodiversity. Energy transition. Colombia has become one of the top countries in the world and in the region on energy transition. We really have made a very important efforts to increase investment, private investment, but also with some government breaks and facilities on solar and on wind power in eolic. And Colombia today is one of the few countries in the world that has a pilot on green hydrogen and blue hydrogen. If that works in the years to come, it really will be a real source of income for the country and will really be strong for a transition in energy. Every time I remember why I'm into this, and especially to you who are in a public policy school, don't forget it's about them. This is why we're here. This is why we do what we do. And every time you kind of feel you're doing this because you're so smart or because you have a great vision about the future, forget it. Only works if it's worth for them long term. And I just keep it to remind myself about it. I think Colombia has a great, bright road ahead. We are expected to keep moving forward, but it's up to us. And as we speak, we are making decisions on every consulate in the world starting last Monday. So for those who think about Colombian democracy, let me tell you, it's very vivid. It's happening. Today in the United States, I have casted more votes than in March, and we're only 2 days. You know, so it's like 60% more votes that we just have for Congress 2 months ago. People is going to the polls. Let's see what happens on Sunday. But you know, I think people values their right to make their decisions, whatever those decisions are. And I like to end with this because it should remind people that we Colombians are not only that terrible stories we have. Yes, we do not deny it. I don't. Because I've been and I will continue to be confronting terrorism, drug trafficking, criminals, and those people that can do bad things for my country and for our people and to the world, because we must. But on the other side, why we do it? Because we have a country that is a lot more interesting than the problems we confront. And you know, this is what we have: scientists, artists, singers, performers, sports people, and with no doubt, the common people of Colombia that was very well presented in the Disney movie that got the Oscar this year for Best Animated Movie, Encanto, because they really were able to portray the sorrow of Colombians that have suffered violence, but on the other side, our family values, our flowers, our nature, our biodiversity, our food, everything that is great about our nation. So I'll finish with this. Could you just play the video? Play it. Thank you. Volumen. Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Ahora sí lo difícil.
Ahora sí. Thank you very much for this big, amazing big picture of the country. And I don't want to be pessimistic, but we have to start to talking about the solution of the problems. And I want to start with a difficult question, and then we can open the room for more questions. It's about drug legalization. It is some space to have this conversation with the United States. We have this big and strong relationship, but we can start to discuss more in a bilateral relationship with the United States.
Well, on that one, I will not be shy, as you can imagine, because I am on the record and probably I've been the person that has fought more that problem than anybody that I know, you know? And even as it has had political consequences for me, because I oppose totally the fact of stopping the tools that we were using to confront drugs in Colombia. And I have to tell you, you know, you can measure whatever you want and use the metric you want, but the only fact is that when we took that decision, Colombia today has 5 times more cocaine than we had ever. And especially, well, starting that moment. And I'm proud to say that at the time I was able to use the full toolkit, the years 2012 and 2013, after I was responsible for doing the policy in 2007, we were able to have the lowest ever production of cocaine in Colombia, which resulted in the weakness of every criminal organization in the country. And at the same time, the increase in investment and GDP growth and poverty reduction in the country. So, you know, when I look to my friends that are experts in economics, I know they need to see all the variables, okay, but I have to go to all the facts. Now, let me go about this. If you ask, should a country like Colombia legalize drugs by its own? My answer will be, it will be the greatest mistake that we already made when we stopped doing the fight. If this is a world conversation in which the world decides, let's make sure we get a regulated market, that's something that as a former or as a, you know, economist by training, I will tell you, I do understand. And probably we need to go that and make that discussion and find out. Now, drugs, in my opinion, are and have different levels of conversation. One thing is to discuss about cannabis, marijuana, and all that stuff. And the other thing is to speak about cocaine that includes all kinds of chemicals and the level of harm that it creates. Not to speak about another set of drugs that are around. Look, I've been in my life, being all my life in public and on the record to protect and defend freedom. I strongly and I'm passionate for freedom. But one thing that I feel I have to tell here is that if I were a magician and I were asked to, you know, do magic or ask the world to do one thing, the thing that I will ask me myself is to create a cancel culture to cocaine. I'm not telling anyone, don't do it, but I'm telling you, make your own reason and stop consuming that. Why is that? I've seen people in modern times stopping their consumption of beef. I respect that. It's freedom. It's up to anybody's decision. Why they do it? Many of them, because they consider that the consequences for climate change of that consumption are not worthwhile, so they decide, I will contribute to the plan. I respect that. Well, how can not people stop consuming cocaine for the following reasons? First, the worst thing that can happen to tropical forests and the Amazon in Colombia is cocaine. Maybe connected to illegal mining, but those two activities are, you know, fully interlinked. You know, why is that? Because they destroy the Amazon and they go as far as they can so they can put the coca leaf. But worse than that, if they decide to produce their cocaine, what they will use there is all kinds of chemicals that will be spilled into the soils and the rivers. But next thing, since the guys that live there and, you know, take the coca leaf, need to be there. You know what they do next? They bring cattle and they destroy another part of the Amazon. So it's not only the coca field, but it's everything connected around. The worst nightmare for climate change in my country, and I have to tell somehow to the world because of the potential we have, is production of cocaine. Second, is the greatest source of human rights violations in the Western Hemisphere. Let's not forget, more killings than any other thing happen out of cocaine business or small, you know, traffic, you know, gangs, bands. And it happened from Argentina to the streets of Chicago. Okay. So why we are allowing that to happen? Why we are giving them the money? But thirdly, corruption. In Colombia, we elected a president with cartel money in 1994. In Central America, I will not call names, but I can tell you they're already elected presidents with drug money. And the Mexican cartels have made Mexico more federal than ever. Not because the government has changed, but because in their own states, they are the ones who are ruling. So now let me think about my country. The fact that we were able to defeat the greatest threats, and then hoping that by, you know, opening a different policy into drugs, we were going to solve the problem, somehow has put us today in a risk that we never expected. Okay. With 5 times more cocaine than ever, or at least than 2015, what we have at now is the risk that that money can flow again into violations of human rights. Social leaders are being killed because of that. And they don't ask which party or what ideology you have. They just kill them if they oppose to whomever is ruling the town. Even if they present up the left or the right or whomever, criminals, human rights violations, corruption. I'm worried now. And I've been discussing this with the friends of the United States and the agencies here. I don't know if some money from drug money or, you know, criminal activities is flowing into funding the political campaign, and I'm worried about it. Not to speak about families. So families from certain economic position, which as we all thrive for freedom, we almost said, well, if one of our family members falls into this, let's do everything in our power as a family to recover that person. So let's make this a healthcare issue, and we recover this person that is in trouble. But a family in a poor town of Colombia, of a single mother that probably is hoping that that kid, you know, brings whatever money or income from his job in order to probably, you know, give opportunity to his other siblings, is a total loss every time one of these kids falls into consumption of drugs. So sorry for a long answer.
No, it's okay.
But I think, you know, we need to reason on all this, and, you know, about maybe on other things I can say yes or no. But in this one, you know, I have to give you arguments that I hope are useful for your thoughts.
Thank you. I want to open the room for questions, so we can start.
¿Eres colombiana, Andrea? Ah, mucho gusto.
He's planning the trip to Colombia, so oh, yeah. This is a big introduction.
You are? Ah, lovely.
So the video, you can use it.
It is yours. It is yours. They have it here. It's yours.
You were just talking about like how coca crops. Oh, yes. You were just saying how much coca crops have incremented during the last past years. I was just wondering, do you think that is that related to how the peace process implementation hasn't been implemented as fast as it should be? For me, it is pretty clear. I used to work in the implementation of the peace process. The lack of power vacuum, the power vacuum left by the FARC, it's a pretty notable thing that has, of course, affected security as well. In that regard, I also want to ask you,
how do you, like, as your, from your position as an ambassador, how do you sense this lack of, in my perspective, coherence from the government in the implementation of the peace process, when also the US has been the strongest ally and right now is one of the biggest sponsors of the implementation?
Well, first, because the peace process was poorly designed. And, you know, I openly have said and say it inside my government. And frankly speaking, I look back and I said, I hate to be right, but I was right. You know, it was a huge mistake to stop the fight and concede benefits ahead of time. And this I told the president of the time, you know, with no hesitation. Let me explain. If you look at the numbers, the real increase did happen between 2015 and 2018. 19 was the last year of growth, and since then it has been sterilized. So the real increase was not during the time of the Duque administration. By the way, I just came this year to the Duque administration. I was not part of it. I even compete with him, you know? So, I mean, being fair, you know, you cannot claim it was lack of his doing. It was lack of planning from the beginning. Second, we knew, at least I knew, you know, being the person responsible for security, that there was going to be a major gap, and it was not about just saying good things in a paper. Because, by the way, every time, even with all the logistics that I had, that I tried to take capabilities from the state, we don't even were able to do it. So we knew that was going to take time. And thirdly, the major mistake was when they offered money to those farmers that were having coca without the guarantee of not keeping the coca. So do you know what they did? I'm going to give you an example of Catatumbo, where I prove it, and Putumayo. They received the money. They are smart people. I mean, the rational players. They took the money and they kept the coca in other fields. So they got the two sources. Why? Because they are poor people. The problem was not about them, but by the way, you know? So my point is, yes, I think implementation were meant to be faster, but it was poorly crafted and planned from the beginning. So now we have a gap. But second, and let's face it, Colombia, in the same years that we are supposed to implement this, had two major challenges. Number one, a migration of 5 million Venezuelans that too have stayed into Colombia. So now we have to feed them as well as to do our challenges in our marginal areas. But thirdly, COVID. COVID destroyed Colombian economy as any other in the world, but was our worst ever recession. So the consequences, even if we wanted to go faster, were simply out of capacity, because then unemployment was not happening anymore only on the marginal areas of the country, but it was happening in Bogota, Cali, Medellin, Bucaramanga, as you know. So I give these explanations first because, you know, I think you are right to make the question. That question I get a lot, but I think I have to because of my experience and the roles that I have played, to be able to explain it, but for one reason, and I end with this. I would never think that the right decision to Colombia now is let's use reverse and let's put ourselves in the past. We cannot do anymore use the tools that we used in the past. But we Colombians of today, we have to figure out what do we do now. And this is not about dogmas. Implement the peace process. No, fight the guerrilla. We need public policy students to figure out what do we do next. Let's not keep watching to the past. Let's keep thinking, what do we do now? Because the past is full of gaps. That's my point.
Thank you. Who want to address both of these?
Hello, Ambassador. You talk about the economic growth of Colombia in the last...
Where are you from?
Venezuela.
Venezuela.
Yeah. You were talking about the economic growth of Colombia mainly in the last 20 years. But at the end, previous to COVID, you had a lot of people on the edge of poverty. That is why after COVID, they became poor again. What do you think you should implement to prevent or to incorporate more people into the Colombian economic growth and become a more prosperous and just society?
So, well, first, we're celebrating the same 200 years, all right? Because the Gran Colombia of that time included Venezuela, so it's the same celebration. Next president of Colombia, whomever that is, I hope can get clear that we need to make a major expansion of our social safety net with some level of concept of graduation of people, because that's the other part. We've been expanding our subsidies, but people is not graduating from those subsidies. So we kind of, instead of being able to focus subsidies in those that need it the most, we are putting a lot of money, you know, everywhere. And once you create a subsidy, getting rid of it is almost impossible, just because politically you need to make people happy. So there's no politician that will say, "Don, let me take that money. You don't need it anymore," because people always need the money, even if they are doing better. That's one thing. The other thing that I believe is very important is keep obsessed on education for jobs. Look, people like you can come to a school like this and spend 5 years and then 2 years and then do a PhD, and you know, it's good and wonderful for the world that it happens. But most of the people, they need 1 year education and a good source of income, and probably get trained a long time to enhance their knowledge and their status if they want, but really they need a real source of income, because they don't have the time nor the money to go and sit to a school like this and wait 6 or 7 years and see what comes next. And if you said, well, let's make sure the state funds everybody, it won't work, because then you will have a problem of quality, in which, you know, not every school is as this one, to use an example. So it's challenging on that regard, and I really believe in programs for you know, education for jobs. By the way, in your city, the former mayor, who I know is now a candidate, really implement such kind of program, and they were trying to bring people from, you know, very low income for a short time education that somehow was connected with companies that can provide them some level of jobs. I think we need to bet on those kind of ideas as much as we can. So it's on the macro policy, a social safety net, better crafted and probably strongly funded, but on the other side, education, but with a big source for jobs, you know, education for income.
Thank you. Okay.
Hello. Yeah. My name is Omar, I'm from Chile.
Hola, ¿cómo estás?
Mucho gusto. My question is related to the humanitarian crisis that Venezuela is living. We have seen that Colombia has taken charge of much of what is happening with Venezuela. I'm not going to say that it's fault of the international community. Obviously, it's fault of what is going on inside of the internal politics of the country. And countries such as Colombia have taken responsibility of what's going on. Chile has done a very poor job, in my opinion. So my question is related, what is the role of the international community, especially the US, that is the biggest economy in the region and the world, right? And one of the ones that implemented many sanctions to Venezuela as well, in supporting countries as Colombia that have taken the responsibility of accepting many migrants, integrating them, and assuming all the costs that the humanitarian crisis is leaving, the Venezuelan humanitarian crisis has caused.
Well, first, I like to see the problem for Venezuelans on two dimensions, and I think that was led Colombia to make its policy decisions. The first one is a moral duty. Let's not forget Venezuelan and Colombians are the same nation, born the same day with the same father, and united forever with all the difference that we can have. But sometimes the only way you can find a difference between a Colombian and Venezuelan is if you really talk to them and get in deep. For the eyes of anyone, will be, you know, very much the same people. Venezuelans have taken care of Colombians in the 60s and 70s, where violence was going on. Now was our moral duty to take care of them. So where else they were going to go? Well, to the next country that is supposed to be mostly like theirs. The second reason was pragmatic. They were coming. Our border is huge and it's porous. And what do? Deny it or make sure that at least you give them the same opportunities that any other Colombian, which are not solutions by fact, just because the poverty and the inequality we do have, but at least to treat them as any other citizen and allow them to have jobs and integrate them into our economic possibilities. I think that has been done, not without a cost, you will describe. The economic cost of this is high. And the only country that has supported really Colombia onto this has been the United States. A little bit Spain, a little bit UK, other countries are not doing what they should. When I see, you know, when the Syrians came to Germany, everything they did for them, or what what's going on with the Ukrainians, you know, is everybody putting money on that? The world has not done that for Venezuela. And I think they should, and they must. By the way, because Venezuelans did not come to Colombia or to any other place because they thought it's fun or better to live in our place. They came because they got a government that destroyed their country, their institutions, their democracy, and their wealth. Venezuela was the wealthiest country in GDP per capita terms only 25 years ago in Latin America. So they really did something wrong there. Not to speak that now, unbelievable, but I have to tell you, is more violent in Venezuela. Caracas is more violent city than Bogota in per 100,000 homicides. So it's kind of amazing, dramatic what did happen. So I think it needs to be, more needs to be done for Venezuelan citizens.
Okay, I think that we don't have more time, but.
Maybe if they do a three round and I'll do one answer.
Oh, okay, you know? Perfect.
So try to make the same question.
I'm also from Colombia, and I wanted to know what's your perspective on how the elections could impact the relationship between Colombia and the U.S.
I'm not allowed to speak on politics now.
I know.
I'll answer around to you.
That's why I'm asking.
Yeah. I think here in the U.S., there's the perception in the Biden administration, I have to tell, that Colombia has strong institutions. I think they even think that are stronger than most of Colombians think about its institutions. But because of that, I expect that in short term, independent on who's the president, the doors will be open. And things might change as time passes and policies do change in Colombia. But for instance, the mill-to-mill relationship is very strong and even goes beyond governments. The fact that Colombia was declared this week, the week of elections, as a mere non-NATO ally, you know, is a signal. So I think they believe onto that. Let's hope they're right, that our institutions are strong and that can take whatever. And let's trust the Colombians, because historically they have been able to be trustworthy. So I trust my people. Let's make not hope, but let's make sure they do.
Thank you, Ambassador. I want to talk about some news that are coming up here about human rights violations committed by not only armed groups, but also for the national forces, our military forces. In particular, the case that was pretty famous was happened in April in Putumayo, I remember that one. But there are also the strike that happened a few weeks ago when the head of the Clan del Golfo was sent to the United States authorities. So there is a biggest concern about what is happening, how much control have the government in the country, in the different areas, in particular the borders, but also how the forces, and you were a minister of defense, you know.
4 years.
very well that that's a very important issue for our forces being involved in human rights violations. And we also have like the HEP statements that have been happening all this time. Those are questions that many students here from different cultures are asking us. What is the inside? And I just want to ask you if you can give to all of us some explanation about what's happening with the Fuerzas Armadas, in particular the head of the Fuerzas Armadas, that is really concerning his speech recently. And also what we can expect about the control from the government in the whole country. How we can assure that we are
good,
a safe
good.
Country.
I wish to have that question at first so I could expand, but I know time is limited, but I'll do my best. First, yes, I think Colombia has lost the opportunity of control that we used to have. And the reasons I already explained, one is cocaine and illegal mining. We allowed that to grow again. And somebody probably was hopeful and they thought, well, now these guys become good people and suddenly these problems are going to vanish. And let's give them some money and they will get out of that. Happened exactly the contrary. And unfortunately, as I said before, people like me who said the country is going to be floating in coca, here we are. The consequence when it happens is that, of course, the territorial control of criminals, forget about which color they have here, criminals, take over communities, and communities have only one chance. Or they do what they said, or they gotta leave. Or the one that confronts them gets killed. Second, the size of our military, the one that I was used to lead, I used to lead up to 470,000 soldiers and police in Colombia. And at that time I was frustrated because I needed 30,000 more. Today, Colombia has 390,000. Part of what was done in the year 2016 when I left was to shrink our military and police. And when this administration, Duque, wanted to increase, COVID hit, no money for that. So yes, we have less people and less and more problem to control. That's one part. Second, from my experience, and this is more a personal take, we need always to emphasize training and professional standards of our military and police. We need to be obsessive with that. I was, you know, the most obsessive person onto that, even to the point of fighting. I got into the other corner. I fired too many people on my time. And I was accused of firing too much generals and not being respectful to allowing them. But I thought that was the kind of signals I needed to provide in order to show what I really wanted as a policy. Extremely high professional military and police that when you compare to the world, and that's why Colombia is a global partner of NATO, that's why Colombia is the star in the Europol and the Ameripol conversations, or is the country that trains more military and police than any other country, with the exception of the United States in the Western Hemisphere. So our standards and our capacities and capabilities are well regarded and well recognized. Now about the cases. Let me start by this. The recent people that went to the HEP, the military, and recognized those terrible crimes, you want to know where they were when I was the Minister of Defense or 5 years ago? In jail. In jail. They were found connected to crimes by our own system, by our own justice, and by our own state. And they were at jail. Now they take them to the HEP, and now they, in order to go home, they say whatever they say, fine, but terrible what they did. Criminals. And where criminals should be, in my opinion, in jail, not in Congress, not as senators. But in Colombia, unfortunately, some of the worst criminals with crimes against humanity are sitting as senators with no consequence. So why some can do it and others can't? Well, all of them should go to jail. That was my view. you know, and even if you have to make concessions, at least don't give them a seat in Congress. Make them free, but ask them to tell the truth. That's my second observation. Thirdly, to the present. The recent action I saw in Putumayo to me was very complicated to explain, and I have to confess, I usually learn not to give an opinion on a tactical situation unless you are in control of the situation. Otherwise, you need to learn. But what happened there, in my opinion, from more strategic perspective than the situation itself, was that's a community fully influenced by the inheritors of the FARC, totally influenced. The FARC of today is not the FARC of yesterday, so they mostly are in civilian clothes, but using even rifles and weapons. They are embedded into the community. And somehow the intelligence was there. There was an action to be done against one of the leaders of that faction. I guess things did happen ahead of time. And then you got all these, including some part of the community in the middle of the fighting. And when that happens, real mistakes do happen, very sadly. So, you know, that's a one, you know, I cannot go beyond that. What would I recommend? And here, as you see, sometimes I don't speak as ambassador, but more as a person responsible and with some kind of background and with some level of duty with my country forever. Well, we need to strengthen our state rather than weaken it. That's a lesson I believe we should learn about the process we are. And if I were to recommend to policy students what you should be seeking, how do we strengthen capabilities of the state, especially on security? Because if you don't have security, then any other policy fails. Because you said, well, we're going to take social development to areas of coca production. But if the community is fully in control by an organization that, you know, oversees them, that policy will fail because they will take the benefit, but they will not get out of the cycle. Successful, really, in the years when advance was proved, was when we were able to bring security and some economic support. But the country has in hand that. We will need probably 20 years to bring to the marginal areas of Colombia, to the Pacific, to the South, to the East, development and real opportunities. And not to forget to the marginal areas of our own neighborhoods in the major city of Bogota, Cali, Medellin, which, you know, are really in a challenge. So that's where I spoke about education and jobs. But that's what I have. Sorry for long answer, but I feel I have to, you know, give you all the perspective on this.
Okay.
Terminamos.
Okay. Thank you very much.
I wish to stay, you know, but you know, we gotta go.